myself, Wildlife Conservation Officer Bergman with the Game Commission, and this is Deputy Wildlife Conservation Officer Bob Fickle. We both work for the Game Commission, which is the agency that's responsible for over 400 wild birds and mammals in the state. Along with the animals themselves, we also cover the habitat. So when you guys are seeing something like this specific animal today, we're the people that you're calling and trying to answer your questions and trying to help you through that process. I want to thank Detective Dixon for calling me today. She's kind of the one that set this up. It helps me talk to a lot more people at once rather than one person at a time on the phone and go over things in repetition. So the animal today we're going to talk about is the eastern coyote. You can see that I have a mount from a coyote that I like to take with me. It kind of helps people understand the size of the animal. This particular mount here is from a 42-pound female that was trapped in Forward Township in Allegheny County, approximately 2006-2007 trapping season. So a little history on these animals. I realize in Bethel Park, you guys, you might see one, your neighbor sees one, and then the word spreads that you have coyotes. I got news for you. We've had coyotes in the state for quite some time. The earliest we can document in pictures is about 1930. It was actually in our own Game News magazine that there was a picture that appeared of an animal like this. Prior to that, we had species of timber wolves, whatnot, throughout the state in the 1700s, 1800s. These animals, they're a little different than a wolf. They exhibit some characteristics of a wolf, but that's just simply because of inbreeding and DNA as they migrated into the state. This specific animal is our largest canine in the state. We have three canines, gray fox, red fox, and the eastern coyote. This is our largest. Pretty much he is at the top of the food chain. He does not have very many natural predators, possibly bobcats and black bears, which we don't have a lot of running around in Bethel. So the characteristics of the wolf that they exhibit is a larger body size than the average coyote that might be in California or Arizona or West Virginia. So we're looking at animals that are on the larger size of the body scale. Our average size for males, adult males, is 40 to 55 pounds. Average size for females is 35 to 40. So here again, this is a 42-pound female, fairly large animal. This particular pelt here, this was from a 49-pound male. So it gives you an idea, just a little larger, almost pushing 50 pounds. We're going to switch off. It's just kind of how we do this program. So I'm going to let Bob talk about some of the physical features of the animal itself that helps you maybe identify it if you get a chance to see it. These guys are very elusive, mostly nocturnal, but they will move through the day, whether they're hungry or possibly breeding season or whatever. Don't rule out that they won't move through the day, because they will. So I'm going to turn the mic over to Bob. He'll talk about the physical characteristics.
Okay, thanks, Doug. First thing you'll look at is, this is not the coyote you see in the cartoons, the wily coyote, the scrawny, skinny thing you see out west. That's a western coyote. This is an eastern coyote. Kind of looks like a small German shepherd. A couple ways you can tell it's a coyote and not a fox. A fox, we had red fox and we had gray fox in Pennsylvania. Gray fox is a lot smaller. A fox would probably come up to there. Their belly. Okay, they're a lot smaller animal. As Doug mentioned, this is an eastern coyote. It's kind of a hybrid between a coyote and a wolf. They came down from Canada through the Catskill Mountains in New York, came down, and by like 1990 or so, they're pretty much everywhere in western Pennsylvania. Okay, they're almost kind of like rats. They'll be here forever. They're really hard to get rid of. They're very smart. They're very wily. And just some physical characteristics of all coyotes, and especially the eastern one, they'll have what they call a bottle brush tail. It'll nice full of a tail, and he'll generally keep that low, or a dog will keep his tail high. Okay? You also see these black stripes on the front. You see these on every coyote, except there's different color phases. This is the most popular. It's kind of like the German Shepherd color, but they do come in red, black. Obviously, you're not going to see the black stripes on a black coyote. There have been some white ones, but this is generally the most common color. I saw one on the streets when I ran down by Chapin's greenhouse last winter. It looked like, I thought it was a German Shepherd, just like a small German Shepherd. What else can I say about it? They kind of have this rufous or reddish coloring behind their ears. Their eyes are generally yellow. And this is a female. She's a little bit smaller than this male.
All right, so there you kind of get an idea of what it is that you're looking for, looking at. Another characteristic that typically you're not going to find in a wild one that's running through your yard, but if you take a hair off the back nape of this animal, that single hair strand will change color 4 times. That's only characteristic to coyotes and wolves. Domestic dogs only have 3. But you got to be awful close to do that, so I don't recommend it. Okay. So let's talk about the animal's habits. You're dealing with an animal that is an opportunist. And this is where the people start getting concerns. My pet, my little dog, my cats, my kids, whatever. These guys are opportunistic hunters, okay? They'll make a meal out of most small mammals or anything that they find. So that's where you have to be cautious. If you have a small dog and you know that there's coyotes in the area, you want to be cognizant of that to not let that dog out unattended. Typically, these animals do not exhibit an aggressiveness. They're usually elusive. You're lucky to actually see one. They're real skittish. They like to run off before they get seen. So that being said, if you're seeing them, you're probably one of the lucky ones. Of course, then the fuel starts feeding the fire, and everybody, all of a sudden, we're overrun with coyotes. The reason we're starting to see them more now in the suburban areas of Pittsburgh, and I have sightings in every area of my district, including downtown Pittsburgh. We have them, they're here. The reason for that is these animals breed and have their young, they have to expand their range. It's just Mother Nature's way. The way these animals breed, every year, the female's going to breed every year, she's going to have a litter. Those young of the year are going to migrate. They're going to move away from their home area where they were born. It's just nature's way to help avoid inbreeding. Those young of the year are the ones that you see filtering into the suburbs of Pittsburgh. Okay? The other reason is abundance of prey. Think about all of the wildlife that lives in the suburbs, in these little woodlots, that attract the top predator that we have in the state. So that's a draw for those animals. The eastern coyote is known for adapting to human activity. They've learned to adapt with us. They live right with us. It was Central Park, New York. There was a coyote in Central Park, New York. That's a piece of woods in the middle of a bunch of concrete. So, he got himself there and he lived there. So, the biggest thing probably is a surprise by people that, oh my gosh, we have coyotes in Bethel Park or Mount Lebanon or whatever. It's just that we have them. So you have to learn how to live with that. The typical nature of this animal is not aggressive. If you see one that is aggressive, it's probably because of a disease. It's probably because of something like rabies or something's wrong with that animal. So it's going to be more characteristic of that disease than the animal itself. The only incident that I've ever had in Allegheny County of a coyote and a human conflict was in Lincoln Borough last year. An individual got approached by a coyote. He had his 2 young children with him. He was an outdoorsman. He knew at that point something was wrong. So he put his children behind him and he started to back away slowly. The animal continued to advance. So he told the girls, go in the house. As it progressed, he ended up going one-on-one with this coyote. He got bit. It got him in the leg, and then it ran off. They were unable to locate it that evening, and the gentleman started rabies vaccinations, which is protocol. You don't have the animal, it's considered a positive. The next morning, the coyote was located by the Lincoln Borough Police, and they were able to put it down. They called me. I took it to health department, and it did come back positive. So what I want you to take from that was characteristics of the disease, not the animal. That could have been a groundhog, a raccoon, a skunk, a feral cat. Could have been anything, but it was characteristic of the disease itself, not the animal. Okay? All right. I'm going to give you a little bit the yearly life of a coyote. There are certain times of the year that you'll hear these guys being more vocal. You might see more movement out of them, and it's because of the yearly cycle that they run. January, they're paired up. The adult males and females are starting to pair up. Typically, they're monogamous. They breed with the same male-female aspect, and they stay together all year. So they're going to breed in about February. Interestingly enough, the female has about a four-day heat cycle in February. The male is only fertile during that period. He's not fertile any other time of the year. His fertility coincides with the heat cycle of the female. It's just nature's way. Okay? So they do their breeding in February. March, they're gonna have their pups. Okay? This is a critical point that they will defend a denning area aggressively. I've had coon dogs get chased back to the truck at this time of year. So they have their pups. They're responsible for, usually the male brings food back, the female feeds them at the den, until the point where those pups are weaned and able to leave the den on their own. She may move the pups from den to den just for safety purposes so that they don't get found and eliminated. This is where the prolific part of the breeding comes in. She's going to breed every year, and she's going to have pups every year. But if the area has the prey and the habitat to support more, she's going to have a larger litter. Okay? That's how they fill the void. So think about if she's going to have three pups or nine pups, but those extra pups, when they leave the area in the fall, have to go somewhere. So that's how they end up in these bottlenecks of suburban areas. Okay? So now you got the mom, you got a family group. The mom, the dad, and a couple pups, whatever was the number that she had. They're in a core area. And they get vocal towards like maybe September. That's how she gets them to congregate. They're not a pack animal, they're more of a family group animal. I've seen them hunt in pairs, but I've never seen them exhibit the characteristics of a wolf where they have packs, where the whole pack brings something down. Okay? So you got this, mom. Question.
What about when they're after young deer, you know, or purple deer, will they pack up then?
Not so much pack up, but they will. This is the critical point that I have seen a lot of that, and I've seen this with sheep depredation, which we don't have a lot of sheep in Allegheny, but in Fayette County, portion of Washington County, there's a sheep farmer that would lose sheep every year. And this is usually the time that it happens is September. And what she's doing is she's training the young how to hunt. It's a training mission, it really is, because they'll go into a sheep farm or a sheep pen or something like that, and they may eliminate or take down a bunch of sheep and not eat a thing. And she's teaching those young how to hunt. So it's not a depredation for food, it's a depredation to train the young how they need to survive. Okay? I've seen two coyotes work together through a creek bottom chasing rabbits. Just like me and you would to hunt them. One coyote goes through the brush, the other one waits on the side for the rabbit to run out. So they're very smart animals. They know how to work together. Not so much a pack way. Okay? So we're in September. She's teaching her young how to hunt. Come October, it's going to be time for these young to leave. They need to go find their own property, their own mates, so that they can continue and produce their own families. Those are the coyotes that we're starting to see now in different portions of Allegheny. and they raise quite a lot of questions because most people aren't used to seeing them. Typically, they don't breed till their second year. So those young, you know, they may be in an area and you'll see them through the winter, but they might not be a breeding pair. It usually takes about the second year before they will breed, although they can breed the first year. So any questions on the animal itself? Any questions on life cycle? Anything like that?
What would be the range for a typical family?
Typical family range could push 30 to 50 square mile. I doubt that it's doing that here simply because of the way of our pockets are. You know, like I said, I have coyotes in every municipality or township or borough in my district. Some of them could be the same family group of coyotes. I don't know that. There's no way of telling that. But our range of the eastern coyote is probably larger than what a typical coyote, like a western coyote, would be, which is about 20 miles. That would all be based on food source. If they deplete a food source, they're going to go where they can find food. They're not going to stick around.
What's a typical den like? A den
could be a brush pile. It could be a rock outcrop. It could be a fox den that was dug out a little larger in size for them. Dens are not found very often.
And do they stay, or how long do they stay around that?
That den is only used for pupping purposes. Now, it's not saying that they won't come back and visit it, but they do not den every night throughout the yearly cycle. That is used to have their pups, raise their pups until they're weaned, until the pups are able to go on their own.
Have the coyotes been tagged at all in this area, and exactly how many sightings in Bethel Park do we have?
I don't have an exact number. I can tell you I had one sighting. Yeah, I had one sighting. Joelle, when was that, 3 weeks ago?
Yeah.
About 3 weeks ago, I had a sighting to the southern portion. I don't get a lot of calls. I'd say my last call in Bethel Park was last summer over by Lowe's. But I get them spread out. I get them in maybe Mount Lebanon, Upper St. Clair. You know, they kind of spread out. And it's not the point until you see one in the same spot time and time again, and it exhibits behavior that I need to be concerned about, like it might be sick, something like that. As far as tagging goes, we've never done a coyote study as far as tagging them. Yeah, there was back in the 80s, it started in Greene County. There was a wildlife conservation officer down there that had sheep depredation, wasn't sure what it was. And he had set some snares, which are neck restraints. And he captured two juvenile coyotes. One was deceased when he got there. The other one was still alive, so he got the bright idea that he was going to put a telemetry collar on this animal. It would lead him back to the den, and he could eliminate all of them. At that point, we were doing a bobcat study, and he had bobcat ear tags. Ear tag number 0026 was the tag that he put on that coyote in Grand County. Didn't say anything but PGC 0026. The coyote eventually shook the collar, and then was killed that hunting season, harvested by a hunter with the coyote ear tag, or Pennsylvania Game Commission ear tag 0026. That was on there so he could identify the coyote that he had put the collar on, and it lost the collar. So that's the only tag that I've ever seen. I'm a trapper and a hunter. I've been a trapper all my life. My first encounter with a coyote was back in probably 1984.
What's the best way to, if you are confronted by or you come across a coyote, the best way to keep yourself safe?
If you're confronted by it, it's typical.
Make noise like you do with a bear?
Typical to any other wildlife, you want to make yourself appear bigger, make some loud noises. Do not approach it, because any animal that feels threatened or cornered certainly is going to defend itself. Here again, groundhog, raccoon, chipmunk, squirrel. You never want to corner them. You know, coyotes the same way. If you see a coyote, my guess is going to be it's going to be a glimpse of it running away from you. That's just the way they are. I'm in the woods every day. Officer Fickley's in the woods every day. I could probably count on one hand the number that I've seen that weren't restrained in my traps at the time. They're very elusive.
Can they clear a 4-foot fence?
Jumping?
Yes.
Yeah, they could. Yeah, they're very, very agile.
My yard's fenced in. Okay. I have a large dog.
Are you the one that called me from the southern portion 3 weeks ago?
No, but I live close to the lumber yard.
Okay.
Every so often we'll hear them.
Yeah.
Once in a blue moon.
Guys, sir, you've been waiting.
Are they endangered infants?
I mean, here again, who's going to let their infant out to the yard on the 10th? I'm not saying it can't happen. It's just not something that happens on a regular basis. You know, it's just kind of like a small dog. If you know there's coyotes in the area, you need to pay attention. Don't leave your dog out there on the 10th. It can't happen. We don't have a history, even in the country, there's not a real history of coyotes attacking humans. We've had a couple incidences, California, stuff like that, where they do, and for whatever reason, it may be disease, it may be, maybe they're injured, maybe they just, they're just awful hungry and they can't look for food on their own.
I'm sorry. What does the scat look like?
Scat from a coyote? Typically, it would resemble a domestic dog, but usually you're always going to see hair in it. So if you're walking on the trails, and whether it's fresh or whether it's old, as it weathers, it's easier to see that hair because the water washes away, the rain might wash away the other particles, but you always see that hair, and it'll actually stay in the configuration of the scat pot. I would say about the size of a medium-sized dog is usually about what it looks like, because fox scat can resemble it too, but it's a lot smaller.
Is it usually spread out or circular?
Usually in a pile, unless something spreads it out, which could be another coyote. They use that to mark their territory. They're very territorial animals, so they want to communicate through that marking, either with that or urine. Question, white shirt.
I saw on the computer that their mortal enemy is actually wolves, but they're afraid of competitors,
Yeah.
They're bigger. Is there anything sold like a deterrent, like a spray with synthetic wolf spray?
A spray
in your yard or something?
I wouldn't put much hope in any type of chemical application.
It's the deer, they don't.
Absolutely. Yeah, the liquid fence is only going to work until the next rainfall.
Yeah.
The mothballs are not going to work. It's a bunch of wives' tale that people get on the internet and kind of put together. The only true way to control these numbers, and we might as well get into that while we're here. Our hunting season is 365 days a year, 24/7. That's day or night, all year long, on a general hunting license. So that's a pretty wide open hunting season on these animals. Our trapping season requires a fur taker's license, and it's only during the months of October to February. So there's a portion of time where you can also trap them. Trapping is by far the most effective means of catching these animals because your traps are out there 24/7, whereas hunting them, you would have to be there at the point that that the animal is. So that being said, as you can imagine, in Bethel Park, there's not a lot of coyote hunters that are going to come here and target the coyotes, similar to the deer, because there's not a lot of open land where they can do that. There's a lot better land where they can go hunt coyotes. Washington County, Greene County, Fayette County, Westmoreland County. It's a lot more wide open. Question in the back? Gray shirt.
Explain your side of trap. When you say trap, people have interpretation.
Do you
have a box trap?
No, I'm talking about foothold traps or cable restraints for coyotes. Foothold trap, in the state of Pennsylvania, we have regulations that limit certain sizes. The largest trap would be a 6.5-inch jaw spread, which is just nothing more than a restraining device. There's no teeth. There's no sharp edges. Properly sized to your target animal, there's no damage. It's a restraining tool. When I trap, if I, let's say that I'm after coyotes and I catch a raccoon, I can walk up, release the animal, and it goes on its way, properly sizing my trap to the target animal. Where you run into problems is whenever people don't take that into consideration that you're going to catch a non-target animal. So it's footholds restraining. White shirt, you.
Thank you.
It gets tough because everybody wants to ask a question.
I'm mostly concerned about grandchildren and children.
Mm-hmm.
Is there a resource on the state that can educate children about their coyotes?
Educate them?
Yes.
I mean, you know,
what to do when they see one.
Yeah, we try to do our part. There's a lot of information on our public website as far as the animal itself. There's probably more information on that website than I can relate to you in the rest of today.
Is it the specific place, though? Specific address on the website?
I believe it is, yeah.
Okay.
Either that or do a Google search for coyotes.
PGC.gov, right?
Yeah, pgc.pa.gov.
Thank you.
How long do they live, lifespan?
Good question. I mean, I imagine if they're eating good, they can live a long time. I would say probably average lifespan will be 12, 15 years. I've never aged the coyotes that I've caught, but when you're getting up into a 49-pound male, which this was, 42-pound female, that's probably a coyote that's older than five. I don't know if there's any. New York did a study, and I don't know if they collected age data or not.
I noticed quite a few farms, especially sheep farms in Washington County, have a donkey.
Mm-hmm.
And I was told that donkeys will literally kick coyotes to the ground.
Yeah. Yeah, a lot of guys, sheep farmers have learned that if they put a donkey in, or some of them will use the fainting sheep.
Oh, yeah.
And that's the give me sheep. The fainter falls over, the coyotes go after the fainter, and the rest of the sheep run to the corral. But donkeys will be aggressive to them.
Okay, sir, I can add one more sign in Bethel Park. My neighbor on March 17th came out to his house to go to work just before the kids in Bethel Park went to high school. But on March 17th, he came out and he had three coyotes in his front yard. I live at the dead end of Bethel on Willow Terrace Drive, which we've got 25 houses going in. In combination with that, I've also got a red fox. Now, I know last year she had two little pups. And she had them at the corner of King School Road and Willow Terrace. Now, the fox just showed up again, pinned my neighbor's cat across the street from me against the door. Did aggressively come after him because he thought he could scare it away. Because at first he thought it was maybe a coyote, but it turned out to be a fox. Did come out and go after them. As far as the coyote, it was just in my backyard on Sunday morning. I've got fresh scat, and it's been used in my yard for the past, this will be the second season.
Right.
So I don't know if anybody's got any cameras, you want to come in, put them in, or trap them, you're welcome to it, but
right.
They're in my
backyard. Yeah, typically as an agency, we do not do removal. There are people that are permitted, nuisance wildlife control operators that are permitted to do that type of stuff. If you're having an issue, these guys are permitted through the Game Commission to trap all year long. If the community or the municipality is looking for some help, they can always go through U.S. Department of Ag, through their APHIS unit, which is an animal control. They have a satellite office down in South Park. There's always somebody out there that can help you do that. If you can do it yourself, as far as being out of safety zones, you know, then you can lawfully hunt them. That's the tough part about these suburbs and the communities. Like I said, nobody's going to come here and target the overabundant animals, whether it be deer or rabbits or turkeys, because of the hassle that they're going to have to go through to do that.
Is there a food source in your backyard? Or feeders or anything around like that?
Not really. They just cleared a little over 9 acres, but for some reason, I've got the deer running through, but pretty much the deer have left.
I'm a bird lover and I like bird feeders, but I tell you right now, bird feeders may cause a lot of problems. They attract mice, other things.
Think about what the bird feeders attracting.
It's attractive mice. This guy loves mice.
Okay.
Occasionally I take a deer, but they're 80% of their diet is small.
How about ground moles, things like that?
Yeah.
Like that.
Yeah.
Got a lot of them.
Foxes will do the same thing.
Yeah.
Foxes will come to the moles.
Yeah.
we get a lot of that. And then we were, you know, wondered, of course, at the same time I got this text message, I was already up, but we also got the high school students getting on the bus at about the same time. So that's a little concern. So a couple of neighbors at the dead end, they're really concerned about it.
Yeah, I mean, one of the, any nuisance wildlife that I get through my district, one of the things is audio and visual deterrence. Certainly, you want to make loud noise. You know, maybe have a can of compressed air handy that you can give a quick blast on that. Those cans work for a lot of stuff. I got people in Mount Lebanon that are using them for turkeys. Wilkinsburg, they're using them for deer. The deer congregate in their backyard. Of course, their neighbor feeds deer, so, you know, that goes hand in hand. And like Officer Pickley was saying, if you're attracting small mammals with a food source, you're attracting the coyote. You're attracting anything that eats those small mammals. So a lot of it could be self-corrected as far as eliminating that stuff until the coyote moves off or the whatever it is moves off, and then put it back out.
I got a funny feeling this group's not going to move off.
Yes.
They've been, this will be the second season if you watch all of that. They've been in my backyard.
Well, they're probably not. They're probably happy living there.
Of course.
You know, they got all the food they need. They got a good habitat. Probably have been successful with breeding already and raising young.
So I'm wondering if it's what the mother was there with her two little ones, because he says the one was huge and the two little ones smaller.
Yeah. So they look a lot bigger in real life than what they typically are. I've been chasing them for a long time. The biggest one I've ever seen was 51 pounds. They just don't get much bigger than that. There's always a case that maybe they could, but you'd have to be eating pretty good to get that big.
We tell a lot of people to get these compressed air horns like you use at a football game. You think of like 10 bucks at Dick's, and they're good for scaring off turkeys and anything else. You just have to use them judiciously because you don't want them to get acclimated to that, and then they don't care. But give them a couple blasts of that, that'll scare them away a lot.
Thank you. Okay, so, Blackshirt.
Considering their short breeding season, do they interbreed with dogs?
I'm glad you asked that, because eventually someone gets to that question. Question is, can they interbreed with dogs? Can they? Yes. Do they? Probably not. The reason is because of that breeding cycle that I told you. The female is only in heat for 4 days in February. Okay? The male is only fertile during that same period. So if your dog goes out tonight and hooks up with a male coyote, it's not going to happen because he's not fertile. So the only way that could happen would be a domestic male dog and a female coyote during the 4 day window in February. Most female dogs are not in heat in February, domestic dogs. So it just, it's not likely to happen the other way around. It has been done. There are koi dogs all over the internet. You know, they mix them with everything, but it's usually done in a controlled environment, somewhere in a kennel. You can buy that, you know, the different mixes, whatever. Who are you pointing at?
Young man.
Young man? Stand up, I can't see you, buddy. They do. They have a lot of noises. A lot of howls, a lot of different howls. Some of them may be the female howl, which signals the congregation of the young. Typically, the yipping and howling, when you hear it as a group, that's the young that are calling back to the female. They'll howl to about anything, fire whistles, car horns, other coyotes. And that's when people start getting alarmed because they realize they heard them here, they heard them there, they heard them behind them. And it was all these different family groups because something made them howl, then they start answering each other. Okay, Brookline. I had a call from Brookline a couple months ago. There's probably one wooded valley in Brookline, and this lady hears them howling all the time. Well, it's because it's the only wooded valley in Brookline. That's what you hear.
It's a 6 o'clock whistle, fire whistle that goes on over in Walden. Obviously, at 6 o'clock, it sets them off. Just listen to that thing, 5 minutes later, they're all going.
Okay, so more questions. Do they howl at the full moon? Yeah, usually something tips them off.
Has a farm out in Hickory, and they were howling all night because
Yeah. Yeah, usually the more vocal portions of the year are when they're congregating to breed, which January, February is when they're pairing up and then breeding. And then again, once the pups are more mobile. You know, they get out, they get mobile, and she uses those locator howls to get them. You know, that's usually the time when people say, I heard them howling. So, all right, let's get back into questions.
In your patrol areas, do you have problems with wild dogs?
Not so much anymore. Years ago, yeah, there used to be a lot of feral dogs. I know a dog warden that was out around Westmoreland County. Prior to the big coyotes being seen everywhere, people would just drop off dogs. And, you know, those dogs would get paired up and breed. And they would live like feral dogs, wild dogs. I would say that feral dogs are probably more destructive than the coyote one is, because those dogs didn't have a fear of humans. You know what I mean? They came from that lifestyle. These guys here, they learned to live in amongst us, but they also know how to be elusive of us. But then, you know, they do get bold, like the gentleman behind you said, he's seen him in his backyard. It's not out of the ordinary. Question, against the window.
Yes, you mentioned a person that had been bitten a year ago. What exactly was he doing? Was he
was walking in the woods with his kids. And when he saw the coyote was actually at that point following him and the kids, which in and of itself is not characteristic of a coyote. So at that point, he became alarmed, you know, possibly this animal is sick. So he started retreating towards the house, a short distance of 200 yards or so. Wasn't very far, but it's a wooded area of Lincoln Borough that goes up into quite a vast piece of wooded area. So he started backing away slowly, got the kids back to the house, and the animal continued to advance. And at that point, you know, it did come after him. So. All right, so we talked about the hunting season, the trapping season. An idea of population statewide, we don't really know the exact numbers, but right now, yearly, annually, hunters and trappers are taking about 40,000 a year. So that's a lot. Okay, that's a lot of animals that were taken out. That would put the population, if you would double it, or close to double it, you're looking at 75 to 80,000 a year. Now this is where it gets tricky, okay? Bob mentioned to you that rats and coyotes and cockroaches are always gonna be here, and that's true, and this is why. This number is the hardest number for people to understand this, okay? In order to stabilize the population of the eastern coyote, you would have to harvest 70% per year, every year. That's to keep it stable. Think about that number. You have 10 coyotes, you have to take 7 away every year to keep 10. Because remember what I told you about her breeding habits? As you take them away, she has more. Because you created a void.
Would the food supply affect that?
Food supply certainly would affect it, because what did I say? If they deplete a food supply, what do? Then they leave. They go somewhere else where the food's easier.
Or fewer pups.
So you see how it goes hand in hand? That 70% number all the time, people just, they have a hard time understanding it, but that's what they are. That's the animal that they are. Out west, they've tried to eliminate coyotes with cyanide, aerial gunners, M44, 1080, and it didn't happen. It's not going to happen. You can't eliminate an animal that can outproduce your elimination ability. Question?
What about compost piles?
Compost piles?
Yeah. I have a neighbor who said he's being rained and he's sending all kinds of branches and wood and old flowers and stuff. Mm-hmm. It's huge. And he said that they were watching groundhogs breed go in and out of there, which I could see. Which I don't like either, but now there's this huge hole in it, and we're afraid that maybe
that
we
could
haven't
be.
Heard anything, but we wonder, you know.
Yeah, I mean, I imagine
not to have a compost pile like that.
A compost pile would be pretty easy to dig in. It would be a heat source. You know, if something burrowed into it, it could be a den. It could be a fox den also. you know, certainly anything like that could attract them. These guys, the coyotes have a way. Their diet is so vast. Their main staple food is a meadow vole, but they'll eat anything. Down south, Mississippi, Arkansas, you know what they eat down there? Watermelons and cantaloupes. The farmers can't grow that stuff because the coyotes eat it. So they'll eat anything. It's just they learn how to adapt.
Yeah, Don mentioned that, you know, they're so prolific breeders. The other problem we have by controlling these animals is really only two ways. That's hunting and trapping. You know, a lot of people don't like trapping. Even the trapping, or the number of people that trap is very minuscule. A coyote pelt is worth what?
About 15 bucks.
About 15 bucks. So there's not a lot of reason for trappers to go out and really trap these things. It's really not financially or economically worth it. Hunting coyotes, as Doug said before, you have to be posted up. They're very smart. You can't be out there 24 hours a day in the woods. So hunting is that's one method, but it's not a good one. And trapping is not that popular. So combining those two things with the way they breed, they're not going to go away.
Okay. Joelle, what was your time frame? Did you have a time frame? 11 to 12? We'll keep going. I know there's a lot of questions. I know you guys are going to have, and you're probably not all going to get a chance to ask them. So I hope that someone covers it, or if not, see us afterwards. But let's go. You have one. I know you would put your hand up.
Are you allowed to bait for coyotes?
During the hunting season, yes. You can actually hunt them over bait. It's one of the things that helps, you know, to try to get them to congregate to an area. Now, here's the thing. If you have some property that is vast enough that you can lawfully hunt it, do you as the landowner really want to put bait out to attract the coyotes to your property? You know? Well, typically out in the farmland, it doesn't matter, but if you're in Bethel Park and you have an area big enough to be hunted, do you really want to do that? So it's give and take. But yeah, you can hunt them over bait. And in trapping, you're using a lower bait to attract them to that set where the trap is.
Real quick, is there any type of sterilization, like birth control, that they develop for a coyote like they did for deer?
And not that I'm aware of. In the
because then if you baited it with the birth control pills, then you wouldn't have all the pups.
You wouldn't. You still have coyotes. And it never worked for the deer either. Questions?
So if we see a coyote in our yard, short of trying to remove a food source or scaring away with a low mark, what do? Does a park animal control come?
Yeah, animal control is not going to do anything unless it's sick or injured. You know, then they can interact with it. Sam, what's your protocol on it? You guys are not trapping. You don't have a NUCO permit, correct?
No, we have before raccoons, groundhogs.
Okay.
I don't believe the coyote is covered under
it. It is under NUCO. If you have the nuisance control permit to do the nuisance wildlife, then you would for the coyotes.
Yeah, we just don't have traps big enough for that.
Where do you use them? Box traps?
Yes.
So you guys are basically municipal run, giving the box traps out and removing those animals?
Yes.
Yeah, good luck. You're not going to get a coyote to go in the box trap. it can happen. I know a few that have done it. But it's foothold traps. And here again, this is why most people are not going to come to Bethel Park to trap coyotes. Because you're going to deal with all the people, all of the domestic dogs, all of the issues that come along with that. So it's just not an area where, me as a trapper, I'm not coming down here to catch coyotes. And being as an officer, I have to come down here and educate you on coyotes. I have to teach how to live with them, teach how to scare them away, teach you how not to cause that interaction where you cornered that animal. That's the main thing. My suggestions is usually enjoy it, take pictures, document it, but make sure you're not the reason that he's there. Because if you are, then you've created that yourself. Same thing in Fayette County with bears. It's a bird feeder until a bear finds it. And it's a bear feeder. Okay? Question in the back. Who was your point now?
Is everyone
run across a sick one, might be trying to attack our pets. Are we legally allowed to dispatch it?
If it's in the act of attacking your pet, yes, you have the right to interact and put it down. If it's just a coyote that's there, being a coyote or sick, I suggest you call the police or SAM. They can do that. The reason is if you get yourself in a bind where you start shooting coyotes in your yard and your neighbor calls and said you were hunting them in a safety zone,
right?
I mean, that's what it's going to be looked at. You know, you can say it all day long that he was sick, but there's certain protocols that you can do. You know, it would have to be if you're shooting an animal in defense or in that you felt was sick, you're going to need to be calling us. So, question?
I might be wrong. Officer Dixon would know. But I thought in Bethel Park it was illegal to discharge a firearm.
Joelle, do you have an ordinance in Bethel?
Yes. We do have an ordinance. It doesn't supersede game laws. I mean, it's still...
And I was going to get to that. So Bethel has an ordinance of no discharging firearms. A lot of municipalities have that. Downtown Pittsburgh, Mount Lebanon, you know, they have their own ordinance. The thing with that, when it comes to lawful hunting, the state law is going to supersede that ordinance. That if they're participating in a lawful act of hunting, they can hunt in Bethel. They can hunt anywhere in the state as long as they're doing it lawfully, regardless of the borough ordinance.
I mean, like, you can't just go out in your yard and see a coyote and decide, oh, I have a gun, I'll shoot him.
If you're lawfully hunting, you could.
No, no, if you're just not lawfully hunting, you don't have a license, you're just a resident.
Yeah. Well, then the thing of it is, if you're just seeing a coyote, you shouldn't be going out shooting anyway. Don't panic. Stay in the house. Don't go out. Question.
We used to have a lot of turkeys running around our neighborhood. They dwindled. They went
to Wilkinsburg and everywhere else. Turkeys are a big food source for coyotes. And that's one of the main things, like in farmland, they say we're seeing all these coyotes and we're not seeing turkeys. They're not the great deer killer that people think they are. Our top animal on deer depredation is actually the black bear. Coyotes was number two, tied with bobcat. And that's fawns, mostly fawns. Coyotes do not hunt and take down full-grown deer unless they're sick or injured. It's typically fawns. But yes, turkeys certainly, and this is where the bird feeders come in. If you're putting bird feed out for birds and the turkeys are coming, it's a food source for the coyotes, so you're attracting that.
I can give you a lady's number in Castle Shannon. There's 30 turkeys in her front yard every day because the neighbor across the street feeds them.
Well, they run through our neighborhood, but I didn't see this.
They just move around.
Your bird feeders, if you put red pepper seed out, that'll deter any type of rodent.
I've had coyotes actually eat black sunflower seeds out of the bird feed. I've seen them do that.
Red pepper seed is what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
Squirrels and all.
You know, my suggestion is if your bird feeder is attracting something you don't want, take the feeder down. I had a lady in Fayette County was on her 20th bird feeder. And the bears had ripped 19 of them down. When she called me, she said, this is my 20th bird feeder. Maybe you need to go to Tractor Supply and try their bird feeders. All right, coyote questions. Let's get back to coyotes. Anything that someone doesn't understand, that we covered, the breeding, the history, the biology, anything like that, do you guys need more?
You had mentioned earlier about them breeding with the wolves. Would that be considered like a coy wolf?
Yeah,
I've seen something on PBS about them moving.
This would go back to the 1700s, 1800s. Remember, we had wolves in this state, okay? Our wolves were extirpated, meaning they were removed. They weren't extinct, but they were removed from the state. When the eastern coyote, or the coyote itself, migrated through Canada, through the Adirondacks, the only thing that they could run into the breed with was not other coyotes, but it was the timber wolves, the red wolves. The gray wolf is actually an enemy to the coyote. That's the only natural enemy to the coyote, other than bears, and we don't have bears in Bethel or wolves. But that's where that interbreeding took place. That's what gives our coyote that larger body structure than that scrawny little thing running in the desert.
Right.
You know, so we do have that DNA in it, and I have a, this is a skull. But the way they do that is the skulls go to Penn State and they actually measure the cranial cavity. Mm-hmm. And that's how they determine how much wolf, you know, how much coyote, what the DNA structure is. Of course, then they take samples too and they're able to do that.
Thank you.
When we're done, you guys can come up, you know, look at whatever, take pictures, touch. It can't hurt nothing. The jaw might fall off of that, but I can glue that back. Any other questions? If you have outside pet food or something to attract them, maybe a smaller dog, I've seen them go on porches.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not out of the ordinary. Typically, if you're sitting on the porch, they're not going to come up there. But if it's through the night, you might leave outside pet food.
Yeah.
Or your dog. Yeah. There was a lady and she was visiting. She was in Mount Lebanon visiting, and she let her dogs out, and the one got attacked by a coyote. You know, and that was right in the backyard. So never say never. Whether it be for a food source or whether it be territorial, it's canine against canine at that point. I've had coon dogs chase to the truck in March because we got into an active den area. And they ran them right back to the truck. They put them in the box. They can be aggressive. In January, I got a couple buddies that have coyote hounds. And we go where there's a lot more land because you got to deal with cars. We run coyotes with dogs, and that's how we hunt them. I've had the same dogs that will chase the coyote. Once the coyote's done running, he's going to turn. He's going to bay, and he's going to be aggressive to those dogs. And you're talking about 70, 80-pound hounds. So you never say never. If you have something that they want on that porch, they're going to come up there. It's not likely to happen if you're sitting there. Yellow shirt.
As far as obviously rabies is an issue, so I got a wild animal, but is there any other health concerns? Like, do they carry any other diseases that could be?
No, they're susceptible to distemper, rabies. Rabies is probably your biggest one because, as any other species, once you have an overabundance of something, it becomes easier to spread that around.
But a raccoon is more dangerous. A raccoon is a more vector carrier of rabies. Than the coyotes. So, raccoons are scarier than coyotes, disease-wise.
Questions?
I was told that at night, the coyotes do not like to go where the lights are. Like if you have overall lights or spotlights, they won't go around
them. Where did we have that one? That was Baldwin. He was walking right down the street, in the street lights. Yeah, I mean, if you had... What they do is they make, the nuisance wildlife world is a large world of different audio and visual deterrent devices. And if you search this on Google, you can see all this. They make strobe lights that are motion activated that flash. That's supposed to deter them. Now, once that light flashes so many times, he's going to get used to it. Okay, they have water sprinklers that are motion activated. So when something trips it, the water sprinkler squirts water on it. Once that happens, it's just rain to them. The trick with visual and audio deterrence is you have to constantly change it. Because once they know it's not a threat, guess what? It's not a threat. So if you're trying something like that, whether it's turkeys or deer or coyotes or whatever, learn to move that stuff around every couple days. Don't just leave it one spot. Geese. I get a lot of nuisance geese, so I tell them, buy a coyote decoy. They put the coyote decoy out there, and a week it works. But then the geese are walking right past it, and they call me and they say, it's not working. Yeah, it's not working because they got used to it. They know it's not a threat. So you got to change that up. Strobe lights, you can try it. I would make sure that I'm moving that stuff around. When I hunt them, I shine a light on them. Some of them run, some of them stop. Some of them give me the opportunity to get a shot. We're at it.
From the guy in the green shirt.
There she is.
We've been here many, many years. It seems that we have friends from around the city. And in our yard, we have 7 bitten deer.
So her statement was the not just coyotes in general, but overall the abundance of wildlife. And yeah, that's what happens when you get into a suburban area where the only natural predator that these guys have is the Pennsylvania hunter. And it's just too hard for the Pennsylvania hunter to come to these areas and lawfully hunt. So most don't do it. I can tell you there are some people that hunt Bethel Park. I check them, Bob checks them, you know, they do it lawfully, they get in those spots. Typically the ones that don't do it lawfully, we hear about, or the police force hear about, and we try to interact with that, excuse me, to make sure that they're lawfully doing it. But there are huntable areas in Bethel. There's huntable areas in Upper St. Clair. There's huntable areas in Mount Lebanon. It's just that the average hunter is not going to go there to do it. Therefore, you don't take the surplus away. Therefore, you have an overabundance of it. So, the programs that Mount Lebanon got into, Upper St. Clair just finished one themselves. You know, they apply for a permit through the agency, and they end up getting into a deer control situation. Do not confuse normal hunting with deer control, because it's completely separate. Two completely separate things. They have a permit, and they're using specific means to eliminate deer. That's all it is. It's control. Okay. They did go through a management program, which I believe Bethel Park sort of kind of has whitetail management doing stuff on certain areas. The park, whitetail management hunts the park. Those are management hunts. That got nothing to do with us. They have a management company that sets up a safe spot and a safe way to hunt, to lawfully hunt. Okay? Anything else? No?
Yeah, even if we had some kind of a program to wipe out every deer and coyote in Bethel Park, unless you wanted to build a wall around Bethel Park, that's not going to work. Because they'll come in from St. Clair, obviously, all the other communities.
This is why the lady that mentioned birth control, you'd have to build a wall.